how often should you have a blood test, and then there's a real brief insight of what the numbers mean. Check it out. Hello everyone, Dr. Jason West with the question I get asked all the time, how often should I get a blood test and what do they mean? And from a healthcare provider standpoint, a doctor standpoint, I love data. I love all the information and it's so helpful when people come in with a healthcare concern and they'll bring in their last year and the previous year and the year before that blood test so you can start seeing trends and patterns. So I recommend at the very least getting a blood test every year. And let's talk about what blood tests are important and some of the findings that help you understand about your own blood tests and about your own health. So one of my favorite things to recommend for people is to get a complete blood cell count with auto differentiation and a complete metabolic panel. And then if you're over 40 as a male, I think you should get a PSA test. I also think it's really good to get a vitamin D level and a T3, T4, TSH thyroid level. If there's any types of inflammation in your body, I think it's good to get a C-reactive protein, and if you're getting a lot of joint pain, I also like to throw in a uric acid test. But let's talk about those tests for a minute and what they mean. A complete blood cell count with autodifferentiation means we're going to look at your white blood cells, we're going to look at your red blood cells, we're going to look at your hemoglobin, hematocrit, your mean corpuscular volume, and your MCHC. On the white blood cells, your white blood cells are the police officers of your immune system, of your blood supply, and what they're doing is they're looking for bad guys to take them to jail. So red blood cells are like trucks on the freeway, they take supplies from town to town. White blood cells are your state police officers, they arrest the bad guys and take them to jail. So your white blood cell count should be between 6 and 8. Optimal is 6.5. If it's higher than that, it means that we have some type of infection that's occurring. If it's really high, it means we have some leukemia. It's also really important to know that if it's low, and if it's down in that 3 or 4 range or lower, it means that your body's just not responding, has a sluggish immune system. Also about that white blood cell count, there's 5 cells associated with the total count. There's the neutrophils, which are the bacterial fighters. There's the lymphocytes, that are viral fighters. The monocytes do inflammation. The eosinophils are usually triggered by some type of allergy or inflammation. And then the basophils can be triggered by parasites and other types of allergies. So the ratio should be 60-30-8-30. Never let my engine blow. That's the mnemonic they learned about it in graduate school. I've never forgot it. So 60% of your cells should be fighting bacteria, 30% viruses, 8% inflammation, 3% of the eosinophils should be your allergies and possible parasite exposures. And so knowing what those ratios are really helps us to understand how your immune system is responding and what type of infection or a type of bad guy that it's getting ready to gear up and to go after. Your red blood cells should typically be around 4.8 and 5, and your hemoglobin hematocrit tells us, do we have any type of anemia, both microcytic iron deficiency anemia and macrocytic anemia. That's the number one cause of fatigue. We just want to know what's happening with your red blood cells. Now moving on to the next recommended annual test is a complete metabolic panel. That is looks at your liver enzymes, your kidney enzymes, your trace minerals, your pH, your blood sugar. It also looks to see how well your body and your kidneys are filtering things. And so I think pH is really, really important. Should be around 25. Your blood sugar should be 90-100. Your liver enzyme should be typically around 25. Your calcium should be 9.8. Your potassium levels should be around 4. Protein should be around 7. So if we have that information, that gives us a really, really nice baseline. And then one of the frustrations that I see about blood tests, particularly with the thyroid, is when doctors run just a TSH, or a thyroid stimulating hormone, because there's more to it than that. You have the pituitary that basically tells, it's in the brain and it tells the body, tells the thyroid if it should be working or not, and it releases a hormone to do that called the thyroid stimulating hormone. If we're only looking at that, it doesn't really tell us if the thyroid is working correctly. It just could mean the pituitary is yelling at the thyroid. So we also want to know what your T4 levels are and your T3 levels, which is an amino acid component. It's really important to understand health. So if you get those tests every year, a complete blood cell count with auto differentiation, a complete metabolic, a T3, a T4, a TSH, males over 40, you get a PSA. Now, if you're having any type of inflammation, it's nice to do a C-reactive protein. It tells us where, if you're having too much inflammation in your system, either from an infection, or you can have some type of cardiovascular disease or autoimmune condition, and then vitamin D levels. Now, typically they're recommending vitamin D levels, anything above 30 is normal. I actually like to see those higher, around 80 to 100, because there's so many risk factors and diseases that go away if your vitamin D levels are high enough, because vitamin D helps with your immune system, it helps with your bones, it helps with your moods and emotions. It's just a wonderful, amazing vitamin. And then a clinical pearl about that. I do have some concerns when people are told to take high levels of vitamin D once a week, like 50,000 units once a week. And I tell people, I just don't think that makes logic, physiologic sense. That's like saying, I want you to go over to the buffet and eat as much as possible one time a week, but don't eat on the other days. You can have 50,000 units on Wednesday, or you can have a big meal on Wednesday, but don't eat again till next Wednesday. It's not as effective of being consistent around 5, sometimes 10,000 units every day. And then depending on where you live and how much sun exposure you're getting, what your vitamin D levels, you can be lower or higher than that. So yes, you should have annual blood tests. You should have the tests that were recommended. It really helps taking all of those blood tests into your doctor for his appointment, so that you can look at the different trends. And you want to see a doctor that knows how to recognize a disease before it's coming, not just when it's the disease state. So one of my biggest frustrations, I had a patient come into the office with some elevated liver enzymes, cholesterol was starting to creep up. The doctor said, well, you don't have cholesterol concerns yet. Let's wait until you do and put you on a medication. That's the wrong approach. We need to do something now before the horse leaves the barn. It's so much easier to treat people from a preventative standpoint than it is from a disease standpoint. And that's my thoughts on annual blood tests. Thank you for watching the video on annual blood tests. They're really important. And if you'll bring them into your doctor on the visits, it'll really help them to help you to achieve and maintain optimal health. If you see value in the video, please give us a thumbs up.